Welcome to Point Loma Church. We are so happy that you made your way here today. We pray that this time together is one of encouragement and a reminder to you of how much you are loved by God. And if you haven't done so already, I invite you to greet one another in the chat. And if you'd like to learn more about the church, have a prayer request, or if you even have feedback on the service, fill out the connection form that appears in the chat. We would love to hear from you. Now today, we are concluding the Relentless Love series that we've been in since the beginning of the year, and Pastor Karla is going to be teaching from Hosea 14. Now I invite you to open your hearts as we prepare for worship.
Welcome to worship this morning. We are so glad that you have chosen to spend your week with us. No matter where you are tuning in from, we hope that you feel the love of Jesus as we seek to grow deeper in faith and be a reflection of his love. If this is your first time joining us online, we extend a special welcome to you and hope that you feel at home here. This Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, the beginning of the Lenten season. If you are local, you can still sign up to attend our simple Ash Wednesday dinner, which takes place at 6 p.m. outside on the turf. Cost for the meal is $5 per person, maximum $20 per family. Following dinner, we will move to the sanctuary for a traditional Ash Wednesday worship service, beginning at 6:45 p.m. The worship service will be live streamed and accessible through the website homepage, just like Sunday morning service. If you plan to join us for dinner, please note that advanced registration is required. Visit our website to register and let us know how many people are coming with you. Registration is not required if you are just coming to the worship service. As a friendly reminder, right after dinner, Pastor Chris and I will be taking the children ages 5 to 12 up to the Children's Worship Center to teach them about communion and the purpose of Lent. So feel free to send your kids with us. After Ash Wednesday, we will continue meeting on Wednesday evenings throughout Lent. This year, our weekly series is called Guided by Saints. Each week, we will gather via Zoom for a time of discussion and teaching. We have again created Lent in a Bag kits with specific items that correspond with the weekly teaching. The bags are available for pickup at the church, or you can request one to be mailed to you if you are outside of San Diego. Visit pointlomachurch.org, register to sign up for Zoom link, and request a Lent in a Bag kit if you'd like. On Sundays throughout Lent, you are invited to join us for Debrief the Sermon. The group will gather at 10:30 a.m. via Zoom for a hybrid time of connecting. The time is intended to build relationships as they gather to unpack, discuss, and personalize the Lenten Full to the Brim sermon series on God's extravagant and boundless grace. All are invited to join to learn together how to be open to receiving one of God's greatest gifts, grace. Look for the Zoom link each week in the chat and at the end of service. If you have any questions, please reach out to Cheryl Louie. Finally, this morning, there are several baptisms taking place today. There are three baptisms in the sanctuary service today, as well as one here in the online service. We have the opportunity to commit that we will support them as a community in growing their faith. It is a great day to be in the house of the Lord celebrating the public proclamations. Before we get to that, let's worship together.
Will you please join me this morning in the prayer of confession? I have failed. I have gloated. I have hated. I have ignored. I have raged. I have hoarded. I have judged. I have turned away. I am sorry. I am exhausted. I am done. Fix me. Heal me. Break and remake me, hold me, comfort me, nurture me, revive me, resuscitate me, bring me back from death. I give you the last word, O God. Will it be grace? Will it be free? Will it be love? My friends, God is not done with us, not by a long shot. You are more beloved than you can ever know, and God is working in you and in the world beyond our wildest imagining. The beginning of all of that is forgiveness, so know that you are indeed forgiven, and be at peace. Amen.
Good morning, my friends. It's so wonderful to be with you today, for those of you online as well as those of you that are present here today. I am standing here with Mark Sisler and Melissa Sisler Mullins, and they are here with their daughter Evangeline, presenting her for baptism today. Today is actually her second birthday, and Melissa and Mark really wanted this baptism to take place in the online community. So we are here in San Diego at the Bay, ready to do this beautiful sacrament. So in the Presbyterian Church, we believe in two sacraments, one of which is baptism, one of which is the Lord's Supper. Those are the ones that Jesus practiced, and that's why we practice them. A sacrament is simply a holy moment where we set aside something that we use every day, in this case, water, for God's purposes. And today, when we baptize Evangeline, we hope and anticipate that the Holy Spirit will take up residence in her life, and this is her inclusion into the family of faith. So we celebrate with them today. And so as we continue, the first question I have for you is, do you put your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord?
Yes.
And is it your desire to raise your daughter in the nurture and admonition of the Lord?
Yes.
Wonderful. I also have here today with us Elder Beth Zedeker, who has a question for you as the congregation. So come on in.
Good morning. In the Presbyterian Church, we believe in corporate godparents. So we as a community are committing to this family to help them raise Evangeline Grace in the church and a belief in Christ. Our Lord Jesus Christ instructed us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the people of this church, promise to tell Evangeline the good news of the gospel, to help her know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship, help strengthen her ties with the family and God? Do we?
We do.
We do.
We do. Thank you. She does too. She does too. All right, if you could all join us now together as we say the Apostles' Creed, as we affirm our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. All right, will you now join me as we pray over this water for God's holy purposes? Gracious God, we do pray today that you take this water that we drink to be able to live a biological life that cleanses us when we are dirty. And Father, that you might use it in Evangeline's life right now to set her apart, Lord, for your purposes. And we ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
You like that water?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Will you come see me?
Let's go for Karla.
Yeah. What? Let's see.
Yeah.
What? Okay. You want over? It's okay. You come here.
It's okay.
All right. What is her Christian name?
Evangeline Grace.
Evangeline Grace. We'll give it back to Dad. Go ahead. If you lean her over. Evangeline Grace, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Was that funny? Was that funny? Oh, wonderful. Well, pray with me, will you, for this family. Can you all raise a hand so we can pray over this family today? Gracious God, we thank you, Lord, for Mark and for Melissa and for this little girl, Lord, and the miracle that she is in their lives. Lord, we thank you for her name, which is good news. And Lord, today we ask that you set her aside, Lord, for your holy purposes, Lord, that she might someday grow up and say yes to you. And we do pray, Lord, right now for Mark and Melissa. We pray for your Holy Spirit to descend in a very powerful way, that you might give them the patience, the wisdom, Lord, the love and the grace to raise her in your name. Lord, that in those moments, Lord, when it becomes difficult, that you might give them your strength and your courage. And Lord, we thank you for this family, Lord, that you've brought to our community and that we get to welcome this little one among us. And so thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, join me in welcoming Evangeline Grace into our community.
Forever, offer us salvation. Well, my friends, we have reached the end of the book of Hosea, and what a challenging book it has been. The challenge began in the opening chapter when God asked the prophet Hosea to marry a known prostitute, have children with her, and be faithful to her despite his own suffering and humiliation. God asked this of Hosea to illustrate the depth of God's love for his people. And through the words of this prophet, we have been challenged to look at our own unfaithfulness and our own self-reliance. We have learned that sometimes God's love is painful as it takes the form of discipline. We have also learned that God's compassion compels God to enter into our suffering with us, even when that suffering is a natural consequence of our turning away from God in the first place. The pages of this book have painted a portrait of our consistent unfaithfulness. Yet, surrounding all that muck and all that mire, we have also discovered throughout its pages God's unending love and grace. And now, the book closes with these words. Hear the word of the Lord today. Return, O Israel, to the Lord your God, for you have stumbled because of your iniquity. Take words with you and return to the Lord. Say to him, take away all guilt, accept that which is good, and we will offer the fruit of our lips. Assyria shall not save us. We will not ride upon horses. We will say no more, our God, to the work of our hands. In you the orphan finds mercy. I will heal their disloyalty. I will love them freely, for my anger has turned from them. I will be like the dew to Israel. He shall blossom like the lily. He shall strike root like the forest of Lebanon. His shoots shall spread out. His beauty shall be like the olive tree, and his fragrance like that of Lebanon. They shall again live beneath my shadow. They shall flourish as a garden. They shall blossom like the vine. Their fragrance shall be like the wine of Lebanon. O Ephraim, what have I to do with idols? It is I who answer and look after you. I am like an evergreen cypress. Your faithfulness comes from me. Those who are wise understand these things. Those who are discerning know them. For the ways of the Lord are right, and the upright walk in them, but transgressors stumble in them. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God today. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for your word, Lord, and the Spirit, Lord, that works in us to help us to understand it more fully in our lives. And so we pray for that Spirit today, Lord, to guide us. Help us, Lord, to meditate on you, Lord, and to see you, to hear you. And we ask this all in your holy name. Amen. You know, when I was a child, whenever my mom would say the words, wait until your father gets home, I knew I was in trouble. I would expect that you can relate to that. You know, all in all, my dad was a pretty decent and respectable man, but he was also 6'3" tall with a deep, booming voice and a man of very few words. In fact, he was mistaken quite frequently for Ted Kennedy, if you remember him. So by his size alone, especially to a little girl, he was intimidating. So those words spoken by my mother sent fear throughout the minds and bodies of me and my siblings. For some of us, that is how we interpret the phrase, return to the Lord. As an uh-oh, now what? But returning to God is less like the story of my father and more like what happened when Hunter Shamat lost his wallet. Hunter was on the way from South Dakota to his sister's wedding in Las Vegas when he left his wallet on the airplane. Inside were the 20-year-old's ID and debit card, as well as $60 and a signed paycheck. Hunter feared the worst, meaning that everything was gone. Not long after, though, he received the wallet in the mail sent by a man named Todd Brown with a note that said this, "Hunter, I found this on a Frontier flight from Omaha to Denver, wedged between the seat and the wall. Thought you might want it back. All the best. P.S. I rounded up your cash to an even $100 so you could celebrate getting your wallet back. Have fun." That is what it's like for us to return to the Lord. It isn't a punishment for wrongdoing, nor do you just get your former lost life back, but instead, you get a new life, a better life, an overflowing life with God's love and grace, a have fun kind of life. So the question is, how does this happen? Well, Hosea ends his book encouraging Israel to return to God and take words. You know, I find this to be a strange thing to bring to the Lord, probably because in our culture, words can be so empty at times. But God does not ask his people for gifts or sacrifices. Rather, he asks us to bring words when we come to him seeking restoration. And there are three kinds of words that are identified here. First, in seeking restoration, we bring words of confession. Take away all my guilt, accept that which is good. You know, there's an acknowledgement here that some guilt is helpful in our lives. Some guilt is what leads us to repentance and motivates us to pursue the path that is honoring to God. But other guilt, the kind of guilt that debilitates and prevents movement, stands in the way of our relationship with God and others. We need God to grant us his grace and forgiveness so that we can stand upright in righteousness. And only God has the power to take away our guilt. And that happens through our confession. Second, in seeking this restoration to God, we bring words of praise. Hosea says, "And we will offer the fruit of our lips." If we are praising God, that means our lips cannot be used for other things. And even though there are times in our lives when praising God feels futile, it sometimes feels false because we don't feel joyful all the time about our circumstances or because we are far away from God's purposes. Even the act of praising God, despite our circumstances, helps us to turn our hearts back to the Lord. Now, I was sharing with the Tuesday Women's Bible Study this past week about my nightly prayer time with my 3-year-old foster son. You know, most evenings I sit on the edge of his bed after tucking him in and prompt our prayer time with the words, "What do we want to thank God for today?" And he always responds with great enthusiasm with things like, "Thank you, God, for going to the playground," or "Thank you, God, for my friends at school," things like that. But since he doesn't yet differentiate between good and bad things like we mature adults do, he also says things with the same enthusiasm like, "Thank you, God, for the owie on my finger," or "Thank you, God, for Soren being sad today." You know, when he first came to us, I tried to correct those parts of his prayer life, helping him become more theologically sound, making him aware that we pray to God to help us and others in areas that are difficult. But then I realized that he understands more than I do most of the time, as the purpose of prayer is to thank God for the good and the bad. And that's what it means to offer God the fruit of our lips. And finally, in seeking restoration, we bring words of commitment. Hosea says, we will not ride upon horses. We will say no more our God to the work of our hands. Israel, we know throughout the story, had been walking a dangerous path, putting trust in their wealth and their prosperity and in their intelligence and in other pointless pursuits rather than God. And part of returning to God was a commitment to recognizing themselves in the correct order of things, that they were not God. To return to God with words was to remember who God is. So when you and I come to the Lord today, these three kinds of words, confession, praise, and commitment, are still the most important things that we bring with us. And Hosea wraps up this book by saying, if we do confess, praise, and commit to the Lord's ways, our restoration will indeed take place. And he uses illustrations from nature to paint a picture of this new Israel, of this new self. First, he says, your growth will be restored. I will be like the dew to Israel. The people will begin to grow again, Hosea says, and not just in number, but in depth. Stagnancy will cease. The selfishness of the people, if you recall, had made them shallow. Our prosperity also makes us shallow. And their lives, just like many of our lives, have lost their meaning. And in returning to God, though, we discover that growth is restored. Second, Hosea says, your beauty will be restored. He shall blossom like the lily. I don't know about you, but during those times of my life when anxiety replaces my trust in God and I toss and turn in bed, avoiding the invitation of rest, besides the headache I have in the morning, there's also the visible reminder of the treacherous night before when I look in the mirror the next day. The bags under our eyes at times indicate our inability to trust, the graying, the thinning hair, the weak spirit. In returning to God, beauty is restored. Third, he says, your strength will be restored. He shall strike root like the forest of Lebanon. Now, the cedars of Lebanon were prized possessions in the ancient world as they were hardy trees with a reputation of wood that was considered all but indestructible. A dead branch of one of those cedars could lie on the ground for years before it would begin to decay. And strangely, insects also had little effect on this wood. If you were lucky enough to build a boat or a house from the cedars of Lebanon, you knew it would last a long, long time. Now, these trees took forever to grow, but they also aged in place well. So in returning to God, strength is restored. And finally, Hosea tells us that your value will be restored. His beauty shall be like the olive tree, Hosea says. You know, olive trees are naturally intriguing, beautiful trees, because over time, when they start to rot, intricate patterns end up on their trunks. And this decay actually makes them quite mesmerizing. But they aren't just beautiful. They also have many purposes. Not only are olive trees used as a metaphor for the Garden of Eden and perhaps even life itself, but the oil from these trees is also used for cooking and preserving and cleansing one's body. So they were needed for both sustenance and hygiene. So in returning to God, we learn that value is also restored. And the best part of this restoration of growth and beauty and strength and value is that Hosea says that it's not just for self anymore, not just for self. That previous life of prosperity that these people were living was a shallow one. But this one, the one found in God, will not just be for them, it will be for the world. They shall again live beneath my shadow, Hosea says. They shall flourish as a garden. They shall blossom like the vine. Their fragrance shall be like the wine of Lebanon. Israel will get to be, finally, the blessing to others that God promised for them in their father Abraham. God will work in them and through them to heal his words and to heal his world. And the same promise holds true for us, Hosea says, if we return to the Lord. You know, the sad part about the book of Hosea is that Israel, the northern kingdom, did not heed Hosea's call. That even though he went to extreme measures and married that prostitute and remained faithful to her through God's command, Israel did not wake up. Israel, or Hosea's telling and showing of God's relentless love, did not change them. Israel still trusted in their own hands. They still spat in God's face. They still believed this life was created by them. So just as Hosea foretold, they lost everything at the hands of the Assyrians, and they went into exile. They were scattered over the face of the earth, and God went silent. But my friends, our story does not have to end the way Israel's did. God has taken extreme measures through his son, Jesus Christ, to wake us up and tell us and show us his relentless love. Some of us that are listening today have yielded to that. And some in Hosea's day did as well. They were called the remnant, and they were the ones who kept the faith waiting for the Messiah. But there are also some of us listening today, some who may have been churchgoers our entire life, that have yet to yield to God's true love and grace. We are far away. We are in exile, distant from ourselves, distant from others, and distant from God's ways. We trust in the work of our hands, and we have forgotten the one who created us. So for those of you who are in that latter group, this invitation is for you. Return to God today. Trust in God. Believe in God. And God will indeed return you home. But may Hosea's message not fall upon deaf ears. But may we all continue to find hope and healing in a God who desperately, and as we've learned, relentlessly loves us. Will you pray with me today? Gracious God, give us ears to hear. Lord, connect us to your spirit. Lord, connect us to your love and grace. Remind us, Lord, that we are not alone and that we can always find a home in you. And in that home, there is restoration. Restore us today. Restore those today, Lord, who are maybe coming to you for the first time. Restore those today that have maybe wandered off the path. And restore those today who are found in your home, Lord. Continue to pour out your spirit. And we ask this in your holy name. Amen.
For you and for me.
I'm not sure about you, but oftentimes when I try to pray, it's hard to even think of the words to say. And so what I've been doing recently is just simply looking at the scriptures and reading all of the many, many prayers that have already been spoken over thousands of years. And so I would encourage you maybe to do that yourself this week, is to find the words that were spoken that might be your words. So this morning I found a prayer from Daniel that was very authentic in the scriptures. He said that he said this prayer while he was meditating on the scriptures himself. So as we pray this morning together, might his words be our words, and might they translate to our God who is here listening and responding. So Daniel said, I poured out my heart, bearing my soul to my God. Just feel that for a second. And his prayer now, let it be ours. Let's pray. O Master, great and august God, you never waver in your covenant commitment, never give up on those who love you and do what you say. Yet we have sinned in every way imaginable. We've done evil things, rebelled, dodged, and taken detours around your clearly marked paths. We've turned a deaf ear to your servants, the prophets, who preached your word to our kings and leaders, our parents, and all the people in the land. You have done everything right, Master, but all we have to show for our lives is guilt and shame. The whole lot of us, people of Judah, citizens of Jerusalem, Israel at home and Israel in exile, in all the places we've been banished because of our betrayal of you. Oh yes, God, we've been exposed in our shame, all of us, our kings, leaders, parents, before the whole world, and deservedly so, because of our sin. Compassion is our only hope, the compassion of you, the Master, our God. Since in our rebellion we forfeited our rights, we paid no attention to you when you told us how to live, the clear teaching that came through your servants, the prophets. All of us in Israel ignored what you said. We defied your instructions and did what we pleased, and now we're paying for it. Just as written in God's revelation to Moses, the catastrophe was total. Nothing was held back. We kept at our sinning, never giving you a second thought, oblivious to your clear warning. Master, you are our God, for you delivered your people from the land of Egypt in a show of power. People are still talking about it. We confess that we have sinned, that we have lived bad lives, following the lines of what you have always done in setting things right, setting people right. Now turn your ears our way, God, and listen. Open your eyes and take a long look at our ruined city, the city named after you. We know that we don't deserve a hearing from you. Our appeal is to your compassion. This prayer is our last and only hope. Master, listen to us. Master, forgive us. Master, look at us and do something. Master, don't put us off. Your city and your people are named after you. You have a stake in us. Now let us join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, this past week has been a clear reminder of our need for God in our world. So I would ask that we might reflect on that this morning in ways that we can continue to partner with him to bring his kingdom here on earth. And we do that this morning through receiving our offering. Freely we have received, and now freely let us give.
And now, my friends, as you leave this space, may the grace, mercy, and love of our Lord Jesus Christ go with you, and not just with you, but work in you and through you to love God's world more. And we ask this all in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
it was great to be together today and an extra special day for my family. So I thank you for sharing in that sacred moment with us and for your commitment to pray and to support us. And I do pray for each of us that today we will have open hearts to hear these words from Hosea so that we can be restored. And that as we use our words to confess and to praise and to commit, that through that we'll experience the depth of God's love and a renewed sense of value and strength. Now I invite you to join us for coffee and community time that we have each week after service. This is a great time to connect with others who attend this online service. It's just a quick, casual way to say hello and to see some familiar faces. Just click on the button that appears in the chat. So I do pray that we all have a renewed sense and understanding of the relentless love of God from this series. We hope to see you on Ash Wednesday at 6:45 or next Sunday as we begin the Lenten series entitled Full to the Brim. Have a great week.